or if you cut a file, they're both different operations. But when you paste it, it looks like the same thing. But KIO jobs can distinguish between these two contexts and call the ISA accordingly to perform the action. So this is what I was talking about earlier, that with the same KIO copy job, you can have an application actually performing many different actions. For example, if you are on the file ISA in Dolphin, it will copy a file in the local file system using kioclient. In case using the FTP ISA, it will download the file from the remote file system when you try to copy it. This file slash ISA is actually what I was working on last year. And in this case, it will send the URL of the file to a KDE daemon to store persistently. And then you also have the KDE Connect ISA, which implements the copy operation differently. So in KDE Connect, it will try to copy the file using SSHFS on your Android phone. So these are KIO slaves. This is, as the name implies, that these are just worker applications. And they help your KDE application achieving the input and output, which is required. So these KIO slaves actually implement the code for copying or deleting a file. And these are out of process, which means that they run in a separate process when they're called. So if I try to copy a file using the file ISA, it will invoke a new file process for that. And then the process is killed as soon as the operation is over. So as such, the ISAs do not last very long. They perform their task, and then they're killed immediately. So, hence the name slaves, I guess. They're actually quite easy to program. It doesn't require much work. You have a C++ header and program file, obviously. And then you have a protocol JSON file. And the protocol file specifies what the ISA can do in terms of like what entries it can list, whether it can list a directory at all, and the path of the ISA, like where the path is for the key launcher to execute it from. I also have written a tutorial on how to write an ISA, a basic one. And that QR code you can try scanning and go into that link if anyone is interested. Or we'll come back to it later. So these are the three components, which rather two components of ISA, the protocol file and the C++ header and CPP file. So with ISAs, you have the slave base. So KIO actually provides you some classes for creating ISAs. One is a slave base class, which helps the ISA communicate with your KDE application. In most, and there are a lot of KDE applications which make use of this. You can try using it in Dolphin, Crusader, or the Polar View Plasmoid. They all use ISAs the same way. And so the slave base class implements this communication between the application and the slave. So you won't have to worry about how that's happening at that level of abstraction. But most custom KIO slaves, which you will use for local file operation, you can directly inherit from forwarding slave base. So this class will actually implement all the local IO operations. So that's another thing which you won't have to worry about. But the nice thing is that you can re-implement these functions in case you want to extend the functionality and make your own ISA. And this is what I did with my project as well. So I inherited from the forwarding slave base class and then re-implemented the methods which I needed to perform a specific action. So there are some caveats when developing an ISA. One thing which must be remembered is that the ISA is a very short-lived process. And this presents some challenges when you're developing one. For one thing, you cannot store any data in an ISA, because if you do, the data will be lost as soon as the ISA is terminated. And the ISA is spawned again when you have to use it again. So the data will never actually be used in any particular way. Then the next thing is that you cannot call a method in an ISA over dbus. Again, because the ISA is very short-lived, and by the time it probably picks up the dbus, it might be killed. The dbus message might be killed. And what else is it? Always remember to execute KDE in file, so KDE launcher can pick up your ISA and execute it when required. And do not forget to end the ISA operations with finish. So if you have a copy method in your ISA, you have to terminate each function with the finish. So this is actually KDE defined function, and this basically terminates the ISA. Without writing finish, your slave will just continue running without actually terminating it. So these are some services. See it again. But in the case that you do want to store data in your ISA, like for some persistent use, you might want to store that in the KDE daemon instead. And because that is a very long living process, it lasts for as long as your session is. So you can try storing data there and communicate with it over dbus. So ISA cannot react over DBus, but it can send messages over DBus. So you can send it to the daemon can store the data, and then the ISA can call it again when you put it. So this is the final thing in the picture. We have the UDS entry. So this stands for Universal Directory Service. And this is how any KIO application will actually see data. So this is just a screenshot from Dolphin of screenshots. Okay. So these are our UDS entries. And UDS entries give you, so UDS entries basically list all the properties of a file. It lists the date of the file, the date the file was created, the time it was accessed, and the permissions which it has. So all of this is obviously stored in the file system using whatever Linux file descriptor is used. But for KIO applications, they need a different way of representing it. So we represent that using a UDS entry. And this object will store all the metadata about the file. So the thing with this is that UDS entries, they don't actually have to represent files. They can also represent things which are not files. So if you open Dolphin, for instance, and you type in settings colon slash, you can see the list of settings on your computer. And this is because of UDS entries, which don't actually need to represent files. They're just objects which can store data. So you can store, so you can make like a UDS entry which is a directory, even though it's not actually representing any directory, and have items under that. And that's exactly what the settings ISA does. It takes a settings top category and makes it a directory, and then has subcategories and makes them subfolders. So you can list all these things in a UDS entry, and then you can specify which properties you want the ISA to display. And the ISA is also responsible for preparing the UDS entry in some cases. So we can go over that one. This is just a picture of how everything works together. So you have a KDE user, any anonymous user. So he executes an operation in a KDE application. In this case, let's say it's Dolphin. And let's say it's a Dhamija job. So first the KIO job gets called by Dolphin. And then it tells the ISA, this is the URL I want to delete it for me. And then it will tell the ISA which folders need to be deleted and which files need to be deleted. The ISA will do the IO operations to the disk, and then the ISA will update the directory contents because it has overwritten all the, because it has rewritten the contents of the folder to the disk, and then we'll prepare UDS entries for the app to display in the folder. So this is just a picture of how everything works together. And then there have been some recent developments in the KIO world. One thing is that my ISA, which was Google Summer Report project last year, has been released earlier this month, so I'm very happy about that. And this actually implements virtual folders for KIO applications, which means that you can, so it's basically a virtual folder where you can copy files and folders, and they're stored as URLs. And then you can collectively select all these URLs and do a file management operation to another directory. Then the next thing is that we have the KIO GDrive ISA, which was in development for a few years. This has been released recently as well. And this lets you access the contents of your Google Drive folder in your KDE application. It works quite well, it works in Dolphin and others. And then the next thing which is coming up is some modifications to the file ISA to allow it to perform super user operations. So as of now, if you go to Dolphin and you try to edit the contents of a drive protected folder like /opt, it won't let you do that because you don't have the correct permissions when you're running it in user mode. Because you run GUI application mostly in user mode, and Dolphin doesn't have the permission to edit directly select /opt. So there are some changes upcoming to the file ISA which will let you do that. So when you try to make a change to /opt, the ISA will trigger a chaos window which you can use to enter a password, and then you can modify the contents of the write protected locations. So this is currently work in progress. It's a Google Summer Code project for this year. And I've been co-mentoring that with Elvis, who is, I don't think he's here today. So this is also coming up soon. So as a recap, we studied like the introduction to KIO and the basic components of it. KIO jobs and how they relate to ISAs, ISAs themselves and how they use UDS entries for displaying it, and then the big picture of how everything works together. And then lastly, I also talked about the recent developments in the KIO world. So I think that concludes my presentation. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer.
that CIO does from the competition is when access a network location like samba or whatever, they do a local mount using Q and give access to applications over that. We don't do like that. We use the samba libraries and there's good reasons for that. But at the same time, it's always the pain point that our mechanisms for accessing samba only work with applications that actually use KIO and we don't bridge to the outside world. What's your personal take on that? Do you think it makes sense to expand the scope of what KIO does to do something like that and sort of address that pain point eventually? And no, David has a strong opinion on that.
Okay, being a
so I'm hoping yet the Clash of Titans.
So that was a rather long question. So the question is, like GIO, which is the GNOME input output subsystem, so that's kind of competitive to KIO in the sense that it works for GNOME file managers, like not this. So I believe it was with Samba, like,
they do a mount into some location in the
using
queues.
Well, like, I actually don't know the implementation well enough of that to have a comment on.
Well, basically, it means that at that point, any application that can do local file access can jump through that. Like, I think they just rewrite URLs to this local path behind the scenes, and then you can do that.
And it does do that. It's mental. They pass a file handle to the application request to it, but also mount it for queues.
Just because.
Yeah. And the idea is you mount it in Dolphin, not Dolphin, other Dolphin. Not this, and then you open your app. But yeah, if you do it form inside the edit, it won't interfuse. Which sounds bizarre after you've gone through all of that effort. But who am I to question it?
I mean, what they do in that sense kind of makes sense, right? You just say, if I'm putting an application that supports GIO, if we use GIO, if I'm putting something that doesn't, then it will fall back. Yeah, I will give it a pass to that mount and it will use that, right? And on paper it sounds great. You get the best of if the application supports the file system, right? The best of file system, you use that, otherwise you have to fall back. What does not make sense is to use synchronous APIs to do network communication. That's really what this is about. If any of you ever mounted an NFS share, you use it locally, everything's fine, then someone steps on the plug and the server goes away. And then your whole system is, or at least that directory or that shell, is blocking for 5 minutes. And you can't get it back because it's stuck trying to do some network communication in synchronous form. And it's not made for that, right? That's where the whole thing breaks apart, is that the find APIs were made for local files, which are always accessible, not for something that's mounted and that will suddenly go away. So that's always been my reservation about using Fuse for these months, but then again, maybe these days they implemented better support for, you know, unblocking new factor and that kind of stuff, I don't know.
Based on the bug reports we've had from Tobias, it does not go better. We have a big problem that there's NFS mount, not Fuse, NFS mount, and the firewall KIO. For our firewall KIO, expects files to archive files. And because they've got an NFS mount, we think it's a file, and we've blocked the plasma occasionally, but it's something not how a network cable.
Yeah.
Another thing I remember is that back when Fuse was pretty new, somebody wrote a bridge that would allow you to mount an IO slave, a KIO slave,
yeah,
using Fuse.
Yeah.
So maybe that's like, maybe it's worth resurrecting that as a fallback thing. Like if you can in KRun somehow tell an application, understand. Like we have those desktop examples where the application can take a path or a URL, right?
Good.
So if they can only take a path, maybe then that's an entry point to fall back to the Fuse mount of the KIO state and handing them a local path.
We have KIO client as well, which is worth mentioning.
We have what?
KIO client.
Well,
it is.
You mean KIO exec, I guess?
Yes.
Which is. Yeah, the fallback we have is we'll download the file for you, ready the application, and then when you quit that application, which uploaded when the file high exactly the server, yeah. Right, it will run fine. Which works for actual Google protocols. Assuming that the application will quit when it's done, which is not the case with all of these unique applications type of thing where you know it doesn't really work that way, right? You launch open office, if it's already running, then the process you just launched will exit immediately and then it's a bit more tricky. Yeah, it's not a proper solution either, right? That's what the problem is. The thing I always liked about Fuse KIO is that it put the problem in someone else's hands. KIO was not touching Fuse. If some people wanted to play with it, they had a choice, right? It's different from the GNOME thing where it just happens in the GNOME.
Yeah.
So if you feel that, like we are redirecting that, go ahead. But
that's it. Are there any more questions?
You share with this, and
this is cool. You're gonna have to use it. I just use it for developing my DSOC project since there's an extra time.
Live demo.
Yes.
Oh, of course.
Okay, so this is just Dolphin, and it's Dolphin, as everyone has seen before. So, this is actually been coming up slowly in a series of patches. So I've been making a few modifications to Dolphin to support my ISO. And they're not very big changes, but they're basically quality of life improvements. So I'll show you how it works. So I opened this here, and this is my ISO running in a split window. And the basic workflow of this is that you can copy files like this, files or syntax or whatever, copy here. And maybe then I can copy some other folders here. And maybe then I can also copy some files inside another subdirectory here. So I've copied a lot of files here. But the thing is that all of these files are just stored in a daemon process. They're not actually written to disk. So this is just effectively a virtual folder where I can copy files from different disjoint subtrees, get them all in one folder, and I can collectively copy all these files to a single directory. So some workflows in this which would be useful is like if you're going through your picture gallery of a lot of photos and you want to select a few which you want to like edit or keep for later, like the good ones, you can just drag and drop all of them to this stash ISA, and then later on you can copy and paste them to your dedicated folder. So one advantage of this is that it reduces the file I/O. So in case you're not using a very fast disk like an old HDD, this could actually speed up your process because your workflow is just copying files to RAM. So it's just copying the URLs of files, not the actual files. And that could actually speed up the workflow in some cases. That's it.
So what happens if you move several files with the same name into this stash?
That will actually cause you... No, actually that would work. That would work fine. Because we are storing the URLs of the files, like the targets of the files, instead of just the file names.
But if you then use the stash and copy it with
Yes, so how it works is that the daemon actually has a KDE watch object in, so that is actually listening for any changes in the files.
Alright.
So if I delete a file, it will not. It will get deleted from the ISA also. So that's just a small demo of my project as well.
Thank you.
No, this actually only works. There's only one daemon process which is running, so you can only have one stash folder as such. Like, it is technically possible, maybe I could work on that later, if people like it. Thank you.